ski champs. I presume that all of you, you are dear and near, are hale and healthy. This is Professor Suresh, delighted to be back again for my 22nd video in process of publication on YouTube today, 28th of May 2020. Selected topic is a real technical wonder in 21st century, which is hovercraft, technical marvel in 21st century. At the outset, my heartfelt appreciation to Wikipedia for explaining even complex concepts and products in a very simple, easy to understand language. I wish to quote the very popular statement, "Fool complicates even simple things, whereas only a genius simplifies even complex things." The fact is, most of the products we use nowadays are highly sophisticated, and very few users have a thorough understanding of all the features and functions and use them the way they should. A classic example is smartphone. Even engineering students lack the knowledge of utilizing the scientific calculators properly for the requisite calculations. Let me get on with the topic. You might have seen hovercrafts in operation in some Hollywood movies. In particular, it can be compared to the hot air balloons and magnetic levitation trains, shortly maglev. The hull of the aircraft, hovercraft, also floats in air, not by magnetic levitation or hot air. This is achieved with the help of what is called as a skirt, SKIRT, filled with air at room temperature but at a higher pressure. A hovercraft, also known as an air cushion vehicle, shortly ACV, is an amphibious craft capable of traveling over land, water, mud, ice, and other surfaces. Hovercraft uses blowers to produce a large volume of air below the hull or air cushion, which is slightly above atmospheric pressure, as I said before. The pressure difference between the higher pressure air below the hull and lower pressure ambient air above it produces the lift, which causes the hull to float above the running surface. For stability reasons, the air is typically blown through slots or holes around the outside of a disc or oval-shaped platform, giving most hovercraft a characteristic rounded rectangle shape. Typically, this cushion is contained within a flexible skirt, which allows the vehicle to travel over small obstructions without damage. The first practical design for hovercraft was derived from a British invention in the 1950s to 1960s. They are now used throughout the world as specialized transports in disaster relief, coast guard, military and survey applications, as well as for sports or passenger service. Very large versions have been used to transport hundreds of people and vehicles across the English Channel, whilst others have military applications used in transport to transport tanks, soldiers and large equipment in hostile environments and terrains. Although now a generic term for the type of aircraft, the name hovercraft itself was a trademark owned by Saunders Roe, which rechristened as British Hovercraft Corporation, shortly BHC, then as Westland. Hence, other manufacturers use of alternative names to describe the vehicles. Hovercrafts are unique in that they can lift themselves while still differing from ground effect vehicles, shortly GEV, and hydrofoils, which require forward motion to create the lift. The shipbuilder Sir John Isaac Thornycroft patented an early design for an air cushion ship hovercraft in the 1870s, but suitable powerful engines were not available until the 20th century. In 1915, the Austrian Dagobert Müller von Thoma Mule, 1880 to 1956, built the world's first air cushion boat called as Luftsen Glideboot in German, shaped like a section of a large aerofoil. This creates a low pressure area above the wing, much like an aircraft. The craft was propelled by four aero engines driving two submerged marine propellers with a fifth engine that blew air under the front of the craft to increase the air pressure under it. Only when in motion could the craft trap air under the front, increasing the lift. The vessel also required a depth of water to operate and could not transition to land or other surfaces. Designed as a fast torpedo boat, the Versus Gleiboot in German, that means fast torpedo boat in German, had a top speed over 32 knots, which is equivalent to 59 kilometers per hour. It was thoroughly tested and even armed with torpedoes and machine guns for operation in the Adriatic. It never saw actual combat, however, and as the war progressed, it was eventually scrapped due to the lack of interest and perceived need, and its engines returned to the Air Force. In 1931, Finnish aero engineer Tovio J. Kario began designing a developed version of a vessel using an air cushion and built a prototype, Pintalitaja, which means surface soarer, S-O-A-R-E-R in Finnish, in 1937. Kario's design included the modern features of a lift engine blowing air into a flexible envelope for lift. Kario never received funding to build his design. However, Kario's efforts were followed closely in the Soviet Union by Vladimir Levko, who returned to the solid-sided design of Kario's one. Levko designed and built a number of similar craft during the 1930s, and his L-5 fast attack boat reached 70 knots, which is equivalent to 130 kilometers per hour in testing. During World War II, an American engineer, Charles Fletcher, invented a walled air cushion vehicle, which was called the Glide Mobile. Unfortunately, this project was classified by the US government, so Fletcher could not file a patent. So far, most of what I have stated is from Wikipedia. Hovercrafts are vehicles which are designed to travel close to but above the ground or water. These vehicles are supported in various ways. Some of them have a specially designed wing that will lift them just off the surface over which they travel when they have reached a sufficient horizontal speed, which is called the ground effect. Excuse me. Hovercrafts are usually supported by fans that force the air down under the vehicle to create lift. Air propellers, water propellers, or water jets usually provide forward propulsion. Air cushion vehicles can attain higher speeds that can either ships or most land vehicles and use much less power than helicopters of the same weight. Air cushion suspension has also been applied to other forms of transportation, in particular trains such as the French aero train and the British hover train. Hovercraft is a transportation vehicle that rides slightly above the Earth's surface. The air is continuously forced under the vehicle by a fan, generating the air cushion that greatly reduces the friction between the moving vehicle and the surface. This way only the speed is higher. The air is delivered through ducts and injected at the periphery of the vehicle in a downward and inward direction. This type of vehicle can equally ride over ice, water, marsh, or relatively level land. The first recorded design for a hovercraft was in 1716, put forward by Emanuel Swedenborg, a Swedish designer and philosopher. The project was short-lived and a craft was never built. Swedenborg realized that to operate such a machine required a source of energy far greater than any available at that particular time, in 1716 and all that. In the mid-1870s, the British engineer Sir John Thornycroft built a number of model craft to check the air cushion effects and even filed patents involving air lubricated hulls, although the technology required to implement the concept did not yet exist. From this time, both American and European engineers continued work on the problems of designing a practical craft in the early 1950s. The British inventor Christopher Cockerell began the experiment with such vehicles, and in 1955 he obtained a patent for a vehicle that was neither an airplane nor a boat nor a wheeled land craft. He had a boat builder produce a 2-foot prototype which he demonstrated to the military in 1956 without arousing interest. Cockerell persevered, and in 1959 a commercially built one-person hovercraft crossed the English Channel for the first time. In 1962 a British vehicle became the first to go into active service on a 19 miles, which is equivalent to 31 kilometers ferry run. However, hovercrafts work on the two main principles of lift and propulsion. When dealing with a hovercraft, the existence of lift is imperative for the proper function of the vehicle. Lift is an essential factor because it is that which allows the craft to ride on a cushion of air several inches off the ground. This process, the process of attaining the lift, begins by directing the airflow under the hovercraft. In order to quarantine the air under the air cushion, a skirt is required. This is done in order to create pressure under the hovercraft which forces the vehicle off the ground. Attaining the proper amount of airflow is imperative for the maintenance of the craft's stability. If too much airflow is directed under the craft, it will then hover too high above the ground, resulting in the hovercraft to tip. Not enough lift will cause the craft to remain on the ground, which defeats the very purpose of the hovercraft altogether. The source of the airflow which propels a craft off the ground is a fan. The fan can be used for lift and thrust. It can be dedicated to lift or thrust, or even both simultaneously. In either case, the passage where the air flows through to reach the air cushion affects the stability of the hovercraft. The passage is a hole located on the base of the craft. Another vital component is a motor. The motor is usually located in the rear of the vehicle and is the heaviest of all the components. Due to the weight of the motor, extra pressure is required under the area where the motor is positioned in order to attain the hovering capabilities. That which makes hovercrafts so efficient, different from other vehicles of its category, is that very little force is required for it to move. Propulsion is that which makes a craft move. The source of this effect is a fan, which is used to move the air for propulsion. However odd as it may seem, the fan produces more than enough force for the hovercraft to move. This is achieved through the existence of another major factor. Hovercrafts have no contact with the ground. Therefore, any resistance to the ground may produce under other circumstances is now non-existent for the craft. As explained above, the propulsion of the craft requires a fan, but a normal fan is not sufficient. This is because a normal fan does not blow air straight back. Instead, it spins the air in a spiral shape. Therefore, engineers decided to use turbines or stationary blades that unspin the air. When air does not spin, more of its kinetic energy can be used for translation and less is required for rotation. The shape of the body also affects the stability of the hovercraft. The larger the area of the base, the more stable it will be. Wider base implies greater stability. Longer and narrower shapes increase the speed but decrease the stability. Most hovercrafts have rounded ends and offer both stability and speed. The skirt, as I mentioned before, is another vital component. Skirt is required for functions such as contain the cushion of air beneath the craft and require hover height. have the stability to confirm or contour effectively over obstacles so as to keep the minimum the loss of cushion air, return to its original shape having been deformed, give adequate stability, offer little resistance to passage of obstacles beneath it, have the ability to absorb a large portion of the energy which is produced on impacts or collision with obstacles greater than the hover height or cushion depth. There are three types of skirts. One is a bag skirt, second is a finger skirt, third is a combination of bag and finger skirt. The most common skirt used in hovercrafts is a bag skirt. It is comprised of a bag that covers the bottom of the base and has holes in it to allow the air to escape and push the craft off the ground. Each part of the skirt inflates independently, which makes repairs much easier and improves the stability. Unfortunately, the more stable the skirt, the slower it will go. The hovercraft is finally able to move, it will most definitely require steering capability. This is achieved through the use of rudders, RUDDERs, like in airplanes. These rudders can be controlled by a variety of devices, including computers. Rudders cannot be too heavy, otherwise they will weigh down the craft because they are located very close to the motor. The shape of the rudder dictates how well it will be able to move the air. When riding a hovercraft, the natural state of motion is easily seen to be constant vector velocity with a constant rate of rotation. A sloping floor will definitely change your velocity vector without changing your rate of rotation. In addition to Newton's three laws of motion, it will become obvious that to avoid spinning or tilting the hovercraft, you must apply the forces in line with the center of mass of the combination of the craft and your body. Piloting a hovercraft is an interesting proposition since very little of it actually touches the ground. There is not much friction, making it very difficult to steer and also very susceptible to strong winds. Imagine trying to drive around on top of an air hockey puck, P-U-C-K. We have discovered that the best way to drive it is to treat it like a jet ski that is leaning back and forth and steering very carefully. It is also possible to do a 360 degree turn without stopping, which is quite a sight. Hovercraft should utilize the principles of aerodynamics to reduce the drag by air and gases in the atmosphere. Stability of the hovercraft on its cushion of air remained a real problem despite some design efforts. A new approach was needed. To solve these problems, plenum, P-L-E-N-U-M chamber with a momentum curtain was developed by Sir Christopher Cockerell. Basically, a hovercraft is a vehicle that flies like a plane but floats like a boat, drives like an automobile, and it can hover over or move across land or water surfaces while being held off from the surfaces by a cushion of air. Gentle terrain is preferred for operation of the hovercraft, but they are capable of climbing slopes up to 20% depending upon the surface characteristics. Prime advantages of hovercrafts are it can travel over any surface, short cutting of roads, travel reverse up as fast as down, irrespective of the current, travel in dry waterbeds, no collision with debris, logs, etc., and access to 75% of coastal area instead of only 5% with conventional vessels. Besides, hovercrafts are very fuel efficient, CO2 friendly, as hovercrafts do not have to plow through the water but fly above the surface. At maximum speed, the fuel consumption of a hovercraft is approximately 70% less than of a fast patrol boat with a similar payload capacity. No turbulence or impact in water as no propeller churns up the water, so sea life remains untouched. Hovercrafts are generally simple mechanisms in theory, yet the process from theory to manifestation is not as easy as it may seem. A plethora of problems exist and must be faced in order to attain a well-functioning hovercraft. The plans and designs must be flawless, One must take under consideration the weight and the shapes of each component in order to avoid problems such as instability and dysfunction. This is a marvelous machine which greatly cuts down the friction, which in turn helps it attain greater speed and more stability. Varieties of problems and factors are to be taken into account in designing and constructing a hovercraft. The difficulties involved in maintaining stability and functional competency has limited the application to only transportation of a military purpose. The cost involved in the developing of a hovercraft is another major impediment to the widespread use of this machine. The future of hovercraft seems uncertain, but there is a good chance there will be a huge hover ports all over the world, like airports. In the future, thinner hovercraft might be built so civilians can drive safely on roads. It also seems likely that the larger hover vehicles will become larger than ever. Hovercrafts are likely to be capable of high flight. Let me call it a day here. Viewers who are more keen and curious for more elaborate information by browse digital information available on net, besides research articles available on this topic. We'll meet again real soon. Rest in peace and harmony. Always watch these videos with a closed caption or subtitles for enhanced comprehension, because I know pretty well that I rushed through to complete the presentation within 20 minutes max. This is the limit that I had set myself, okay? And this time, I hope I managed to meet that limit. Bye.